Good evening. My name is James Carroll, and I'm director of the New Arts Program in Kutztown. And we're very fortunate this evening to have with us, it's called New Arts Alive, but it's not alive unless we have someone with it. And this evening we have Jonathan Santiofer, and he is a painter from New York, one of the few New Yorkans that was born in New York. And so what we're going to do is be spending the evening with him and sort of fracture the evening with different activities, past activities, and some of the future activities that will be going on in the spring. And what I would like to do is start right off with Jonathan acquainting us with some of his paintings that not only can you see in an exhibition that is now on at the New Arts Program exhibition space. We just had an opening this evening just before we came in, and Jonathan will acquaint us with some of those works or like works. And tomorrow evening he will be giving a presentation in Kutztown at St. John's UCC, and we will talk about that later. Also, I would like to mention that if any of you would like to call in at times throughout the hour, if you would like to ask questions or there is something that is causing you to be inquisitive, don't hesitate. And Jonathan, if you would, sort of acquaint us with what you're working with or you have been working with in the last year.
Well, I could start a little earlier. Most of my work, or all of my work for quite a while, has been sculptural. Actually, if you show number 5, which is in that magazine, you can show a few of those pictures. That goes back to 1982. Those are all flat paintings. You'll soon be seeing them. They were painted in a way so that they appear to have a kind of sculptural presence. And I think I've always been interested in paintings that could grab the viewer in a way because they felt that they had a kind of strength and form that convinced you of their existence. And I've continued with that for a number of years, always sort of taking the clues from my own work, moving along with the things that have interested me in my paintings and things that I see in the world. The paintings you're about to see, this painting, which is called Edge of Night, is a large, flat, horizontal painting that, for me, was the idea of a painting that was just sort of one unit, sort of an organism that unfolded, flipped around itself, very sensuous form combined with sort of more geometric form. The painting was a kind of, I guess, a breakthrough for me. If you show one of the others on that page, at the same time, I did a group of paintings that related to dance, particularly some dances that Merce Cunningham had done called duets. These paintings are my idea of trying to make, this is one of them, it's called Duet One. Those are two panels that are flat, that just sort of abut each other. When you see them in person, they seem three-dimensional. There were a series of 3 of these, and I thought of each panel as a kind of dance partner for the other. They are very sculptural.
In a way, Jonathan, when you say duet and you're referring to Merce Cunningham, in a way they take on a figurative character.
Oh, absolutely.
As opposed to just being purely abstract or what most people would say, non-objective.
Well, I think
so. The figurative element becomes a whole ploy within all of your work, really.
Yes.
It is not separate from, but an integral part within the
picture. I don't think my work has ever been totally abstract. I have always, or for many years, I've been sort of categorized by writers and critics as an abstract painter, and I often find myself in exhibitions called abstract painting. But I've never thought of my paintings as totally abstract.
It's kind of a misnomer.
Well, my paintings always have stories, or they come out of things in the real world. My most recent paintings, if you want to skip over some of the things that are there.
But I think the one that would be kind of fun at this point would be that panel, the three panels, because I remember the story you were telling about the preparatory process that you were doing in dealing with that, where the lake.
Oh, okay. This painting,
and I think that would help very much.
It's number seven. This is a painting, what James refers to. My paintings, because they're shaped and they're very elaborate in their presentation, people always assume when they see the finished painting that I've planned it perfectly, you know, that all these edges, when in fact I do very little planning, that the paintings change as I develop them. The painting, it's called The Passion in Our Time, which is this, is a freestanding, it's in the little exhibition that James has now in the New Arts Festival. It's a pretty big painting. It's about 7.5 feet or so
84
tall.
84 inches tall.
7 feet tall. Three panels that are 3 feet wide each. The sections in the middle sort of cantilever in and out of the surface. It began as a painting that was mostly gold leafed. It was a big swimming pool with figures around the sides of it.
Yeah, the swimming pool that you said was in the bottom third.
That blue sort of trapezoid, triangular shape, it's hard for you to tell, was a kind of swimming pool. And in fact, I before I named the painting, I used to refer to it as Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous, because I had this big swimming pool and these big nude figures, and there was gold all around the painting. And in the middle of the painting, I sort of hated that, decided it was sort of disgusting, and took all the gold out, turned the figures into those brown sort of hills, and the whole painting just changed for me, and it became an interior of walking in and out of doorways to nowhere, coming back. So the painting changed for me, but most of my paintings do change.
But the element being that there is that objective awareness, the figurative awareness, that most of the listeners this evening probably would refer to your work generally as
abstract.
Being abstract, but that the premise for it, the basis for it, and the whole working relationship in the process of it is figurative.
Well, in some ways, it's funny because a lot of my abstract painter friends are really going to hate me for this. But abstract painting is not quite enough for me. I love looking at all kinds of painting. I mean, I love painting. But for me to work, I often need my own stories. You know, I'll show you some things if you can sort through. I brought a mess of pictures. I'm sorry. Things that I decided at the last minute to pull things off of my studio wall that were important to me. And the one that's number one is, I think, my all-time favorite painting, if that can be such a thing. It's Giotto's Lamentation Over the Dead Christ. And it's a painting that I've had on my wall for, oh God, many years. Is it? No, it's not on there yet. Anyway, this is a painting. There it is. Beautiful painting. I finally got to see it last June. It's in the Scrivigni Chapel, the Arena Chapel in Padua, in Italy. And it killed me even more. But I thought this painting had, I've always thought it had everything. You know, it has great story, drama, all the action. It's fantastically set up with that hill that comes and points down to the head of Christ, and the angels going crazy up in the sky. And I wanted to do abstract paintings in a way that had a lot of feeling like that. Another thing, to show you the diversity, I think of things that I like and I'm interested in. If you can find pictures 14 and 15, which are little photos that I took, when you get to them, I'll show you my idea of sort of religious icons that I like. These are shrines on the sides of the road in Italy, and I took as many as I could see. I was driving along with my wife and daughter in Italy. We were there for a while, And at the beginning, I would drive them nuts because there was another, and we'd have to pull off the side of the road and take the picture of the Madonna. After a couple of days, my daughter, who it was 5 years old or less at the time, would say, "Daddy, there's another," and so it became a thing. But to me, these little Madonnas and shrines on the sides of the road, these are two of them, and I have maybe 50 that I photographed, they were art, they were filled with meaning. You know, people can talk about them as sort of kitsch, layman's, religious icons, but at the same time, to me, they were all, you know, they were art for the people, they were a whole bunch of things.
Were they made by the individual craftsmen or artists
of the area? I have absolutely no idea who made them. Every day, if I passed some of the same ones that I'd seen, people would come in and put flowers there or little things. Anyway, I did an actual painting that relates to these. It's a painting inside the catalog that has a number 10, I think, 9 written on the front, and inside it is number 10. It's called Stones. What happened was I didn't know I was making a painting that related to these shrines, which is what happens to me. You know, I see some things, I get interested in it, and then the next thing I know, it has somehow invaded my work without me being totally sure of how it got there, and then I look back and there it is. The painting you will be seeing in a minute is called Stones. I was making a painting that had the shape of a kind of house or a shrine, and I thought if I cut a hole in it and made a window in it, it would turn into something else. I guess maybe I should wait till this goes on and you can... About to?
Well, Jonathan, yeah. To help along with yeah. this, your interest also has been that you have been teaching for a number of years course in early Renaissance, comes with this Giotto. And
no,
what
I've
am
actually,
I doing? Getting
no,
ahead?
No. I've actually stopped teaching the course. It's been an interest of mine. I teach course actually about modernism.
I thought that you were. My favorite period of art is
12th, 13th, 14th century Italian.
That's early Renaissance.
Early Renaissance painting, which I love. And what I've done on my own is I go and seek it out. So I've gone to Italy. I was fortunate enough to spend a day on the scaffolds in Arezzo to see the Piero della Francesca's and watch the restorers try and save the paintings, which was really very exciting to me. And I think that. I love that art, but...
Is there a work that we're trying to...
We're trying to find
it?
One?
Is that the one?
Yeah, that's it. Can you pull back on that a little, or...
Gee, we found it.
We found it.
It's sort of like a treasure chest.
Yeah, keep going, that's good. You can see it's shaped sort of like a house, which was sort of like a shrine. I don't know if you can make it out. In the center, that rectangle is a cutout that falls back just about a couple of inches, and it has a little shelf in front of it with glass behind it. There's a stone sitting on the shelf, and then there's a painted fake stone behind there, a kind of outdoor landscape. And then there are these sort of Gothic architectural steps on which are painted stones and then real stones. What happened also in the middle of this painting, while I was working on it, my grandmother, who was 90 and who I'd obviously known my whole life, died. And somehow this painting became important for me in that way as well. Also, there's a tradition of leaving stones as markers on grave sites. And so this painting became a combination of these Italian roadside images I'd seen, a tribute to my grandmother, and of course also a totally abstract painting where I work different elements against each other. You know, I always think of the formal abstract elements as well as the other things. I think a painting is a million things at once. You know, it has to tell a story, it has to be visually exciting, it has to have, I want to hook the viewer. I want them in there, so.
So when you speak of telling a story, you're speaking of narrative.
Yeah.
And I remember the talk that we had on that Sunday morning when I went up to pick up the paintings, that you also said that you had an interest that is completely void of painting.
You're spill the beans.
Yeah. Is that spilling the beans?
It is, sort of. I'm a closet writer a bit. We won't talk about that, though. We'll just
no, but it does go along with that narrative in that you do like to write.
Yeah,
and I think that that's very important. A lot of people think that artists are sort of closeted in many ways, in that they're incapable or they don't have any desire at all. And
I think
that they do. Contrary to that, I think they're probably very versed because they have to become very much involved in searching out and in one way or another researching certain aspects and finding out about things.
You know, some artists are not articulate, but and this is not always true, but I have found that some of the best artists are extremely articulate, very well read, know about a lot of other odd topics that one would not suspect. And I think all of that and all of what you read and see and do reflects back into your work. And one of the things I like to do, since I feel that my work always comes out of itself and what I do and the nature and the history of painting, I think I'm tied to that. I try and take a trip, if possible, every year to somewhere that I will somehow stimulate my work. You can get ready. I'm going to ask you to show a picture.
We'll get to that, which will be
number two.
What we're going to do is, as they say in commercial television, we're going to take a commercial break. What we're going to do is we are going to show you and talk with a minute about the Meredith Monk benefit. We have a unique opportunity in Kutztown on March 18th of this year, and what we are going to do is have Meredith Monk, and we have the audio, some audios of her music to go along with the visual flyer that we have of Meredith, and what I'm interested in is that you not only can hear maybe a little of her music, but you can also read it, and also I can speak with you. So we have almost every medium of communication going on at the same time.
Can I say a word about Meredith?
Yes, you may.
For those of you who've never seen Meredith Monk, she is an exceptional performer. She has one of the, I think, most amazing, versatile voices that I have ever experienced, and she's very exciting. She's done tremendous work, and one of the, I think, the sort of quote performance artists who has continued doing work that she started out to do and is committed to. So I wouldn't miss it. You know,
she's been working since the late '60s, and her music is, there's no way of explaining it. It's so unique. Do we have a sound and a? Well, there is the one side of the flyer, and Meredith is on the left, and Nurit is on the right, and there will be the two of them. They will be performing on two concert pianos, and it's going to be an exciting evening.
I think,
and it'll be at 8:30 on the 18th of March. Go right ahead.
The thing about Meredith Monk is that I've seen her do performances that she. Oh, well, you should listen to her. So you don't have to listen to me.
This is from the Dolman piece done about 10 years ago. Near the end of the program. What I would like to do is go back with Jonathan and cover a little more distance, and when we come back again, we'll come back with Joseph Egan. Do you, part of what we were talking about is an aspect that we haven't gotten in too much with, and that's the dimensional aspect of your work. They have moved from not only being shapes of many varied kinds, but the dimension, in other words, moving out to the perceiver space,
yeah,
or within the perceiver space. And how are you working with that, and how do you look at it in relation to your own perception, and what kind of perception do you sort of wish of the perceiver?
I never wish the perceiver to have anything but their own perceptions and feelings. Everyone brings something of themselves to your work. And I don't think you can particularly control the stories that people bring along to your work. I present what I have to say and what I'm trying to do, but I'm also very interested in what people see in the work, which is always quite different from person to person. In terms of the dimension and the structure and sculptural form, I like it because it makes people come in close to a painting. It makes them want to touch it, which they're never supposed to do, of course, but I think it's a nice idea. And it makes them, I like the physical toughness of actual form in a painting. And I've been more and more playing in my new paintings with sort of trompe-l'oeil effects, that, you know, very realistic depictions of an object as well as the real object. So that the viewer is even pulled in closer to the painting, that they establish a kind of intimacy with the painting. I've always felt that paintings were kind of a world that you're invited into, that they draw the viewer into them, into themselves. And actually, I think if a painting doesn't do that, it exists as wallpaper. It hangs on the wall. It doesn't do anything. And I'm not interested in that. I'm not interested in backdrop paintings. I like paintings that are fairly obnoxious in their presentation, and they will not go away. You know, the worst criticism I usually get about my paintings is that they're too much and they're too complex, and that's just fine with me. You know, that's the kind of criticism I think that's good. And I believe in paintings that are very rich and take a long time to unravel, so that you take time with them. You know, you notice different parts of them.
Well, then the unraveling has to do with the perceiver in this case.
Yeah, yeah.
The dialogue that goes on between.
I hope that a viewer establishes a kind of dialogue with a painting. I do want to move the viewer. I mean, I hope that can happen. You know, I watch people sometimes in a gallery, especially when they go to my shows, if I'm sneaking somewhere, hiding in a back room, I watch how quickly people go by a painting. You know, 2 seconds, that's it. Painting you've worked on for 2 years, you want to grab them by the neck and throw them on the floor and say, look at this, you know. You can't do that, so the painting's got to grab them by the throat, right? Or it's got to hit you, it's got to hold on to you. And not every painting's going to do that for everyone. But hopefully you're going to do some paintings that will pull in different people at different times. And I'm not saying that's my objective when I start a painting. I always want to just learn and do more things with them. But I know that I do want paintings that engage people. If you're not going to do that, there are enough paintings already in the world, you know, so.
But that isn't going to stop you from painting.
No, unfortunately, I'm going to keep flooding the world with more paintings. It's just, I won't stop.
No, but I did know an artist who stopped painting because he says there's too many in the world.
People say that, and it's true. There are, I mean, you know, I think of the last time I went to the Picasso Museum, the new Picasso Museum in Paris in the spring, last spring, and the work was so overwhelming to me. I mean, it was so great. It was the best of the best of Picasso. When I was on the top floor, I had two feelings. One was of overwhelming wanting to go home and create new art, and the other was to jump out the window and kill myself, because what was the point? You know, I mean, somebody had already done all this great stuff. But the lesson I took away from Picasso was that you just do whatever you want to do in your work, and just do it, you know? I mean, this work killed me. It was too great. But anyhow, so I went home, and I didn't throw myself out the window, and I continued to paint, and in fact to take more chances. That with the new paintings you're talking about have branches in them, the stones paintings. I'm doing a painting now. I'm using photographs in my paintings in both realistic and unrealistic ways. At this point, there was a time when I think I had rules about my paintings. I have no rules anymore, and I'm I'm willing to do it. I also, I've been painting, I feel, for a long time, you know, 20 years, and at a certain point you let yourself break your own rules, so, right?
By then you've already gone through all of them,
that's
and
right.
you've become,
that's right.
they don't excite you anymore.
No, they don't, and one of the major thing is, I think, if you're not interested and excited in your own paintings, nobody else is going to be interested in them. Which I'm always astounded when I see people repeating paintings over and over, although I know that, I understand that it's very comfortable. You know, Gertrude Stein said, you know, once you do something good, you naturally want to do it again, and it feels good, you know. But for me, I've got to keep myself going in the studio, so it's always something new. It's a little scary at times, and I think that right now I'm very worried because the new paintings scare me that maybe they're corny or silly, and I know that someone's going to say that, and I'm going to have to be very upset, but that's the way it is, you know? So you have to keep sort of forcing yourself to take those risks in your paintings.
Do you have another one that you would like
to... Yeah, I had set you up for a different painting. I know that. I'm sorry. inside the stones, the one where you had stones, if you show the one to the other side of it, and then you could, I guess, show the one on the cover, those are newer paintings. All of which use elements from, I would say, the real world in some way. Yeah, there you go. That's, you could show the, yeah, right, that one.
Also, I'd like to mention the works. There are 7 pieces in the exhibition right now. And come this Saturday, after Saturday, there will only be 6.
This is true.
Because Jonathan is taking one of them back home. And it is one that is... seems to fit well with it, but it has to go.
Yeah,
but,
I'm sorry.
If you have a chance tomorrow or Saturday to get up there, you'll be able to see all 7 of them. And they do cover a range going from 81...
To the present.
To the present.
Right.
Through 88. So,
right.
So you can see a matter of 7 years, at mm-hmm. least of... almost
right.
7 years, 7 pieces.
It spans a period. Some of the paintings relate to the early ones I showed here. The newest painting is one with a stick, which is a small painting which is the painting I'm stealing and bringing back home. it's only allowed out of the house 1 day a year, and I have to get it home. The painting that will be going on here, this painting, is called Missed Kiss, but if that's the way it looks, the way I'm looking at it now, you are missing the kiss totally. In the center of the painting, that's not your fault, it's just sort of darkening out. In the center of the painting are 2 heads that sort of overlap. It's a kind of folded fan. Those folds that you see are, well, you can't see the missed kiss, doesn't matter. What I've done in this painting is the outer shape is like a fan, and there's a real wooden frame that's a rectangle that goes around it, and then there's a painted wooden frame, a fake painted frame in the middle. And right in the middle, the area that looks totally dark, are 2 ghost-like heads. They're trying desperately to do it, and
it just won't
be there. I think the title is very apt at the moment, Missed Kiss. It is missed, that's what I meant that. But the thing about that painting, is that I've always been interested in frames, and I've started putting frames on the sides of my paintings and around the paintings. And that one I just smashed right onto the front of the painting and into the painting.
So in that one you had the shape of the canvas, and
right.
then you had a literal frame.
There's a slate nose there. You can
make
it out in profile in the middle.
Well,
but
can't get much
It's
closer.
Pretty good, guys. Don't worry about it. It's
but
okay.
there we have that... peripheral of the frame right there of the monitor. You can see where the what is
yeah,
real
what I,
frame.
I was just saying,
and
you
then
framed
inside
it
is the false frame.
Yeah, you framed it on the monitor very well, because what you've done is you've framed my real frame, which cuts into the painting, and then in the inset on the sort of that parallelogram is a painted frame. You see, it casts a fake shadow, and it casts its fake painted shadow onto the real frame. If you look on the left corner there. And on the right corner, that little frame paints itself over the real frame. So I've been playing, you know, that to me is not a big deal, playing with illusion and reality. People have done it for years and hundreds of years. But I think I've been interested in it in two ways, in both an abstract way and in the sense of what it does to the space.
Well, they might have been doing it in painting, but it's only been in the 20th century that they've literally been going from the surface to the perceiver space.
Yeah. Well, the thing about a painting like this is that it does bring people in close to it. They want to see what is real about it, what's happening in the painting.
Well, we've tried to get in
and
closer
you've tried
to it
and
to see that.
Yeah. Well, we'll just take that one right off the screen
there.
And we'll forget it. You can, yeah, we'll talk about some.
Okay, well, what we'll do is break again, and what we'll do is go on back to back to the first weekend in November when we had Joseph Egan, who has been living in Europe for a couple years. Joseph is actually from Allentown. He went to school also at Kutztown, undergraduate, and he's had a fellowship for a year at Zurich and is now living in, I'm trying to think of the name in Germany, not Vienna, Strasbourg, in which he has been having a few shows, but I would like to, is it coming?
Right.
Okay. Here we go. These are sort of dealing with the work from the most recent going through to the most distant, or I would say about covering about 4 years. What we have is, these are, some of the shots are taken from the catalog that you just saw the cover of, and others are taken from slides that he showed at his presentation in last November. What he does is he builds the surface up using paint, plaster, any kind of material. And in other words, it isn't into the surface, but it's from the surface.
Yeah.
So you're, but it isn't that it's tactile of great depth. It's sort of, he has a similarity like you. If the thing is around, you sort of want to work with it. And
a junk collector,
to a
yes.
point.
Right. Yeah,
like it's supposed to be worked on, you know, it grows.
Right. Yeah.
It grows with you.
Mm-hmm.
And so, and his work is sort of, he has referred to some of his work as vessels because it's something that grows, something that contains. And his particular, this is Joseph. Joseph, we had a, he was on New Arts Alive in November. Aren't I right? Wasn't he? this show was what was called Cabin Fever, and what he did is he took the whole gallery space and more or less contained it within spaces, and it almost set into this claustrophobia type of thing, dealing with materials. In other words, one object extends into all of them in a way. It is not something that's separate into itself, and they. They extend out from the surface. They so there is a consultation with the piece, just like you were speaking of wanting people to be actually assaulted in some ways with it.
Well, simply that they can't somehow just pass by it quickly.
I mean, you get hit by it or in one way or another.
Yeah.
Or by the board being in your way, physical. Now, what's kind of interesting for after he got his graduate degree, a lot of them, or graduate students, have a tendency to teach. And Joseph was one of the few that I've ever heard it literally expressed so simply, and that was that when he got out of graduate school, he didn't want to teach because he didn't feel he had anything to teach. He hadn't done anything. All of it was in the school structure, institutional structure. And for 8 years, he worked with the UPS in New York City. And you know, that, if nothing else, will get you going. The hours that you work. So with his fellowship that he had for a year, it became a great deliverance for the motivation end of it. And it wasn't that during that time of working for the UPS that he didn't make things. He had a couple shows in Germany and in New York.
Well, artists,
it was very difficult, and he was very sincere. And if somebody can work 12 hours a day doing a physical job and go and create, you've got to have your hat off.
I think that artists traditionally have always done that. You know, I remember years and years ago people saying to me, gee, you're very lucky to know what you want to do and be an artist. And I said, well, you know, you can be lucky too. You can work all day and then try and paint all night and have no social life and never go to a movie. And sure, it's really lucky.
Nobody wants to do that.
But I think that's what traditionally artists have done for a long time. So luckily I'm not doing that anymore, so I'm happy about that. We're back.
Okay, we're back. And what we'll do is we'll continue with seeing some of your images.
You can flash through some of the images that I haven't,
that you haven't presented,
mentioned, and I'll say something about them as they come on. So just if you can do that.
Just float them in.
These are a variety of things. Some of them are paintings of mine, some of our things. This is a postcard from Lascaux, the caves at Lascaux, which I was invited to go into. It's closed to the public, but you can get permission if you're an artist. And
see the one unique of being an artist.
That's right. And it was, you know, these are 25,000-year-old paintings, which is amazing to be in there and see these paintings. I mean, it makes you feel this spiritual connection to man. It also makes you realize that art hasn't gotten much better. It was never, you know, it was just as good then. But it related to things I immediately found it relating to a lot of the work I was doing in terms of spaces, the way even these artists were, I call them artists, but they were making images that formed with the rocks in the cave and moved around. And I just could find things that I personally could relate to in my work. This painting, which is hard to read in a way, but the center of the painting breaks in and out of the surface. It's a rectangle, but the forms, that greenish form there, literally breaks out of the painting. It's called The Lure of the Entrance, and it was done, I started it before I went to visit the caves in France, and I finished it when I came home. And it was the idea, I started playing with all that white around the edges of the painting. Was like a wall, and the forms broke in and out of the space. So in some ways, I think the things I had just seen certainly affected the work I was working with.
Was the perimeter then done when you came back?
What happened
the
was,
white?
The white was, and I contained it. There's a frame around the edge, a painted wood frame, just to hold it together.
Yeah.
The white was as if it was a wall. This is a basically totally abstract painting in that way, except for its relation to my feelings about the way Paleolithic artist or Paleolithic man used the form that he painted on or drew his pictures on. I think that it's pretty hard, I think, not to be affected by things that you, other art that you see, and yet you always incorporate it into what you're about in your work. It's always, your work seems to take precedence over what you've seen naturally, but these other things filter through it.
Yeah, but I think it's very important for people who are listening in that when you speak about your relationship, you're speaking about now, whereas the work that we might be looking at is Paleolithic. We're talking about something 25,000 years ago, and there is a difference of time.
Absolutely, but you know, I have a theory about the Paleolithic artists. You know, a lot of these paintings, which they're still unsure about. I read several books when I came home because I was not that schooled in it, in terms of relationships to hunting, of course, and successful hunt. But my personal theory was that the Paleolithic artists were the boys who didn't play baseball well, and they'd say, okay, you guys go hunt, and I'm going to stay home and paint pictures, you see, because that's what I would have done. So I identified with them on a kind of personal level as the non-athletic, non-hunters of the group. It's true, we have no ideas about what they were, what their society was made up of. If you show some other images, then, oh, this is about a big 8-foot tall painting. It's a shaped painting, but it is a flat painting. It's very vibrantly colored in real life, intense red. There's a white hot center that goes into a hot yellow. It's called The Legend of Musume Dojoji, which I named for a kabuki story, because the color reminded me of the Grand Kabuki. There's a telephone call. Is that it?
Oh, okay. A telephone?
All right.
Do we have one? Good.
Hello.
Hello. Hi.
I was looking at your work, and it's mostly all abstract. So I guess you just... I'm a painter, too.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And do you paint what you want to paint for yourself, or do you paint what you feel other people will appreciate?
I think it's both of those things. I think when one paints, they're always pleasing themselves, right? Otherwise, you don't paint, I would imagine. I think if you paint to just exclusively one or the other thing, if you paint just to please yourself, you may end up with a very narcissistic package that nobody else cares about. On the other hand, if you just paint to please other people, then you're maybe not painting out of yourself. I'm not sure if that answers exactly what you...
Well, see, when I paint,
uh-huh.
and I paint something that pleases me, and I paint it, and I think, this is the way I want to paint it, and this is the way I think it really looks good,
uh-huh.
and I have somebody saying, well, this should be that way, and that's I can't accept that criticism because I like what I painted.
Right.
So if I take a photograph and I paint it exactly the way it's painted in the photograph, then they say, oh, that's really nice, that tree looks nice, or that stream looks nice, but it's, I don't like it.
Right. Well, so then you're happier painting what you want to paint.
Yes.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
I think that that's probably the avenue to stay on, because you usually, look, you, it's impossible to get everyone to like what you're going to do anyway, right?
All the time.
You know, I always love seeing 10 different people's reaction to the same painting, and I'm sure you've felt that. And you have some people who love it and some people who just think it's awful,
mm-hmm,
right?
Mm-hmm.
So hopefully you feel that it's a good painting. If you don't, there's probably no way to defend it unless you feel good and strong about the work. I
well,
know
your
that...
Your work is
yeah.
very good.
Thanks.
So many different dimensions. It's beautiful. It really is.
Thank you very much.
Well, I'm not, myself, I'm more into the scenic and the real mm-hmm. life type things. I did abstract already, but I'm mostly into the real life things. And the way I feel that I have to paint is if I don't make it look true to life, nobody's going to want to buy it. So I make it look, I make each leaf look like a leaf.
Right.
But I personally don't want to do that. I want to...
Well, so don't worry about if they're going to buy it. Just paint your leaves the way you want to paint them, and then someone will come along who love your leaves the way you love them, right? You
know? Be able to
or
see
be able
a
to
leaf
see them.
The way you
That's
do
right.
it.
That's right. You know, I went for a number of years without selling any paintings. I didn't start showing my work until I was about 30, and it was much later that I started selling paintings, and I've been fortunate enough to live off my work, but, and I worry about it constantly, of course, that something will change. But nevertheless, I found for me that the paintings that I never can gauge which paintings people will want to buy. Sometimes I think this painting is really a winner, you know, it just looks great and it's, I don't know. And then
yeah.
it's, nobody buys
and
it.
And then nobody likes
yeah.
it.
Yeah. And then another painting that I think is a real dog,
I
you
know,
gets sold and I don't get it, you know.
I know.
So it's, so you can't really gauge the public, I think.
That is so true. And you think, well, I had quite a few art shows, and I thought, oh my God, I hate to put this painting up, you know, because it's like, you're ashamed of, not that you're ashamed of it, but it's not your best work.
Hmm.
And as a matter of fact, I just completed one, and two people saw it, and the one woman said, oh my heavens, such a gorgeous painting. She took it in and showed the other woman, oh my God, look at this painting. And I said, you know, this is not my best work.
Never say that. No.
It's not my best work. I have better things than what they were. They were getting so excited over this painting, and I thought, come to my attic. I got 15 more that are better than that in my attic, you know. Oh.
Well, I always try and not let out of my studio the work that I don't feel, you know, that strongly about, because then you often have mixed feelings about showing it, you know, and there it is, and it's out there in the world, and you're not that happy with it,
and
so
your name's on it. Yeah.
Yeah. So I think that it's probably best to just show the work you're strongest, feel strongly about. But
well, I guess
thanks.
That's good advice.
Good.
So I'll keep the others in the attic. Huh?
Yeah. Well.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Mm-hmm.
Bye.
What I would like, Jonathan, at this moment is to go back over and see an exhibition that we had in November.
Sure.
Out at Penn State, Berks campus. It was Frank Mann, and I think it's a little section that would be interesting to, yes, if you would. Two things, he deals with boxers. And this comes from his own personal experience, not that he was a professional boxer, but it was something he was interested in. And if you go over to his place, he's got these boxer shoes, you know, his shoes. And so he's dealing with this. He also came from Washington, D.C., which is a political boxing arena. also, if you will see numbers on his work, and those are titles. In other words, dealing with ABC, you can translate it. And here you can see back behind the boxing figures, you can see the numbers and the imagery that are in it. Now, his work basically is very little to do with tactile quality. It has more of a staining quality. One of the persons that he studied with, you would know, I don't know if all of our viewers would, but Gene Davis. Mm-hmm. So coming from that kind of staining color concept, even though Gene worked with pin lines or small, fine vertical lines. But he does deal with symbols with the boxer, which obviously is a symbol in itself. Borrowing from different periods of historical time, as you can see, different parts on it, references to it, and it's. I think by seeing this along with yours and some of the others, they can get a perception on different.
Well, one of the
ways of looking.
I think one of the things about the art world now and has been for a while is that it's all over the place. I mean, there. It would be impossible to not find something that didn't interest you. I think in this point in time, there's so much. So much variety, which I think is very good and actually healthy.
Okay, now we're back, and we'll have a few minutes to spend with Jonathan before our time is up, and then we will end the program with Meredith Monk and some more music from Meredith. Now then, in your is there some other pieces that we did not get
that's
to?
A,
okay, here we are.
That's a large painting. What you can't quite tell about it is that it, from the center, it's two pieces. From the center of the painting, the vertical center, it's about an inch from the wall. And as you move out toward those corners, it comes off the wall about 10 or 12 inches, so that it sort of opens up like a book. And there's this big swirling shapes. The paint's very heavy in that. It's called Scenes of Heroism. It was actually a pretty important painting to me. Have I said that about every painting? I hope not. But this one was, in a lot of ways, there's the swirling shape you see through. It's transparent. And I'll give away this ridiculous secret, which was I was painting the painting, which was totally abstract. And I was sitting drinking a cup of coffee through a glass cup. And I looked at the painting through the cup, and it was perfect. And I painted the cup into the painting, which became abstracted, but it's that white form. And in the painting, when you see it in real life, you look through that, it's transparently painted in, with glazes, thin glazes of color.
But the white on there is not thin glazes.
Yeah, some of it is. It is quite thin. It looks heavy here, but it isn't. Most of my paintings I paint with either with parts of it are very thin in glazes and other very thick and heavy, because I like to make the paint feel as if it's expressive in different ways, you know, that it's like having more than one voice or touch.
It's kind of difficult using white as a veil or thin.
Yeah, it is.
Because it's so opaque.
It was a lot of fun to do, to thin it down just with varnishes and linseed oil and turpentine to see what sort of veils you could get. And I actually would have to repaint the objects behind it many times to get it to work. So. That was actually the reason why I said it was important. It's one of the first paintings where I started to work with transparencies, and I've continued to use that in different ways. In fact, I'm now working with painting on glass as a transparency that you see through to other images. And I found that to be amazing because it's like a level of space out in the world that's wonderful. Plus, you can cast shadows from painting on the glass back into your painting, so that you paint something that's not real, and then it casts a real shadow into the painting. And to me, that's kind of been an exciting thing to play with. This is a big, dark painting, not quite as dark as it looks here. It's three panels. It's also like a book. In the very center there, what looks like little white lines, it's an actual door that you open up, and there's a mirror in there that's been glazed over with color. But the door can either be opened or closed. If you open it up, essentially what you get in the painting is yourself. And I did this painting because I got a lot of reviews from the show just before this. The critics wrote that my paintings were about empty spaces without figures. And I thought, I'll paint a painting with a mirror so that we'll get a figure in there, you see. I thought that was it also had a history of mirrors and, you know, throughout the history of art and the way you can create portraits in paintings. You know, I think another image might be coming on as we near the end here.
I would like to mention, as we wait for an image, and that is that the 23rd of this month, we will have David Brenman, musician, composer, who will be on New Arts Alive. And that will be at 9 o'clock, Thursday, February the 23rd. David has been spending this year over in Berlin on fellowship, so do tune in. You can turn in, too. Tune in and speak with us. If you want to call, I find that very interesting and kind of stimulating in a way. Do we have any more? Okay.
Well, that was an announcement from a show of mine. It is a view of my studio, or was my studio at the time. The paintings there, you can sort of get a sense of scale, but there's a little stepladder in the corner. Those are both very big paintings. And they're both paintings that related, I did them after I'd been to the caves, and there are forms in the paintings that break in and out of the surface. When I say they relate to the caves, they only do it in the most, you know, peripheral way, but, these are fairly abstract, and these are about 1985, I would say, or 19, yeah.
Well, there is the frame, like the one that I see on the left. It does suggest down in the lower right the peripheral.
I've always been interested in frames as well. That painting in the back is called The Hunt, and there's actually a shape of a sort of horse figure in it, which reminded me of the painting. There's a famous cave painting that I went to, which is these horses with hand prints around them, where the artist signed it with their handprint in a way. And I was sort of playing off of that at the time when I did that particular painting.
What I would like to do now is close the evening program with music of Meredith Monk. And the flyer announcement. I would like to thank Jonathan for coming.
Thanks.
And visiting with us, because it.
Well.
I just find them, everyone that I have in, exciting, and I like talking with Jonathan. There's the problem is we only have an hour. We don't have two or three. So we'll just have to go on to the next.
Talk
oh, you're
on,
willing to? Oh,
on,
if you so want to call no, in after
no,
the program,
no, I'm leaving. But, I have been known to
okay.
Talk in my time. Yeah.
Well, we've had our station breaks and all the other things, but let's go off with the continuation of Meredith and the flyer, okay. If you would.
La la la.